Hallelujah. Glory. Amen. Shall we turn to the scriptures? Psalm 37. Hallelujah. Amen. From verse 1, it reads on this wise: fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity. For they shall soon be cut down like the grass, and wither as a green herb. Trust in the Lord and do good, so shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thy heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth thy righteousness as the light, and thy judgment as the noonday. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Cease from anger and forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil, for evildoers shall be cut off, but those that wait upon the Lord shall inherit the earth. For yet for a little while, and the wicked shall not be. Yea, thou shalt diligently consider his place, and it shall not be. But the meek shall inherit the earth, and shall delight themselves in abundance of peace. The wicked plotted against the just, and gnasheth upon him with his teeth. The Lord shall laugh at him, for he seeth that his day is coming. The wicked have drawn out the sword, and have bent their arrow, their bow, to cast down the poor and needy, and to slay such as be upright conversation. Their sword shall enter into their own heart, and their bows shall be broken. A little that a righteous man hath is better than the riches of many wicked. For the arms of the wicked shall be broken, but the Lord upholdeth the righteous. The Lord knoweth the days of the upright, and their inheritance shall be forever. They shall not be ashamed in the evil time, and in the days of famine they shall be satisfied. But the wicked shall perish, and the enemies of the Lord shall be as the fat lambs. They shall consume into smoke, shall they consume away. The wicked boweth and prayeth not and payeth not again, but the righteous showeth mercy and giveth. For such as be blessed of him shall inherit the earth, and they that be cursed of him shall be cut off. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighted in his ways. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him with his hands. I have been young, and now am old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. He is ever merciful and lendeth, and his seed is blessed. May the Lord add blessing to the reading of his word. Amen. Since I was young, now I am old, I have never seen a righteous man forsaken, nor his children beg bread. Hallelujah. Amen. Fill my way every day with love. Shall we pray? Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you this morning. Lord, it's another resurrection morning. It's a day that you have made, and Lord, we are glad and we are rejoicing. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of last week. We thank you, Lord, for the blessings of last Sunday. My God, let the redeemed say so. How you spoke to us, Lord, in such a special way from our brother Tim Pruitt. And Lord, we are never the same again. And Lord, we came back here last Monday, and Brother Chidi reminded us, Lord, that it is a battle of the gods. Hallelujah. And they that know the name of the Lord their God, hallelujah, they shall be strong and they shall do exploit. Lord, you are the one who's leading this battle. It is your battle, for the battle of angels became the battle of men. And Lord, you are our God. So Lord, we are standing here in your name today. And Lord, in the name of Jesus, we have the victory. Hallelujah. Every demon is bound to flee. When we come in the name of Jesus, there's no one can stand before. Lord, we thank you this morning for the opportunity that you've given us to be back in your presence. Lord, just to worship you, to praise you, and to love you. Lord, hallelujah. Lord, we are lost in your love this morning. Hallelujah. Lost in your goodness and your mercy. How that you've come to remind us according to your word this morning that we should not fret, we should not be afraid, Lord, of the wicked, we should not be afraid of the evildoers, but Lord, we should trust in the Lord. And Lord, we are trusting in you this morning. We are trusting in your word. Like the song says, it is so sweet to trust in Jesus. Hallelujah, just to take you at your word. And Lord, your word said, Lord, we should not forsake the assembly, the gathering together of brethren of like precious faith. And that's why we have gathered here together, knowing that where two or three are gathered together in your name, that you will be there in their midst, and you will be there to bless them. Lord, even as we have come this morning, may you bless us in such a special way. And Lord, may your word, hallelujah, comfort in power, and may it meet the need of the hour, may it meet the need of the people, may you go straight to the believers' heart. And Lord, may you give us faith in the inner man. Lord God, if there's anyone who is sick here this morning, may your word heal them, for you send your word and it heal their diseases. Hallelujah. All of our afflictions, may they fall before thee this morning in the name of Jesus Christ. May you touch everyone in your august presence. And Lord, may you bless our pastor in such a special way today. May Lord, he speak spirit spoken words. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ, Lord, we rise against Satan this morning and we resist him. We cast him out of this sanctuary, out of this auditorium. Lord God, he has no place in us. Hallelujah. Glory to God. He has no place in this auditorium. Lord, may the word of God come forth in such a mighty way. May there not be any hindrance this morning. May the word, hallelujah, find a resting place in the heart and in the soul of the people. Hasten those who are on their way and those who might not be able to make it. May you bless them as well. May we have a wonderful time in your presence. May your refreshing drop down upon us. Hide me behind Calvary's cross this morning and the musicians. May we make one sound this morning, and may your name alone be praised. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray and ask the blessings. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, just worship him. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, don't you just praise him. Oh, praise him. Praise him. He's worthy to be praised.
Feeling what I feel again. Oh, there is nothing I like better than God's children gathered together. It feels so good being here again. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Amen. Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for another day like this. We thank you for your grace and your mercy, Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for your power that has been here, Lord Jesus. Even if we dismiss right this hour, Lord God, we can say, Father, with all boldness that we have been blessed, oh Father. But Lord Jesus Christ, it's fallen my lot, oh God, to stand behind your sacred decks. Oh Lord, you know, Lord, I'm not worthy, Lord. I'm just hiding myself behind your cross. May you come down and make yourself real to your people. Oh Lord, may you take your word as the great teacher and teach it to your people, Father, Lord God. If there be anyone that is in here, Lord, that has lost courage and have lost confidence in the message of the hour, Lord, may such a one receive that confidence back. Is there anyone here that is backsliding, oh God, and thinking about going away? Lord, may such a one receive faith to carry on around this race, Father. Lord Jesus Christ, may you heal the sick. Oh God, restore the backslider, oh Father. Fill all of us, Lord, with your Holy Spirit, because we cannot receive it too much, oh Father. We ask for your grace and your mercy. Be with us, oh Father, for in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Amen. Please, while you're still standing, so I don't take much of your time, I would like to draw your attention to two portions of the scripture. Matthew 2, verse 1 to 12, and 1 John 2, verse 12 to 14. Amen. Matthew 2, verse 1 to 12. If you're there, say amen. Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the west, from the east, to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and are come to worship him." And when Herod the king heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and the scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel." Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search diligently for the young child. And when ye have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also." When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being warned of the Lord in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed into their country another way. Amen. Let's turn to 1 John 2, verse 12 to 14. 1 John 2, verse 12 to 14. "I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven you for his name's sake. I write unto you, fathers, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. I write unto you, young men, because ye have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, little children, because ye have known the Father. I have written unto you, fathers, because ye have known him that is from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because ye are strong, and the word of God abided in you, and he have overcome the wicked one." May the Lord add his precious blessings to the reading of his word. You may please be seated. Amen. How many are happy to be in the house of the Lord? Amen. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Sincerely, there's no better place to be than to be in his presence. Despite your condition, despite your situation, the best place to be is in the presence of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I would like to thank the pastor for this opportunity to stand behind the sacred decks, praying that the Lord will be my help and my strength. Amen. How many of us appreciate our pastor? Amen. By his grace, we'll be looking at a very short topic that is titled, "We Have Seen His Star." Amen. We have seen his star. And then if time will permit us, the inspiration would be the battle for the young. That is if time will permit us. Amen. We'll be dwelling on the thought, "We have seen his star." In the Bible we read in Matthew 2, we are made to understand that there were wise men. They came from the east. These wise men, they saw a star and they followed that star. When they followed that star, they went to King Herod. And you will notice that when they went to King Herod, the star that they were following disappeared. Amen. When they went to King Herod, which is seen as a denomination, the star that they were following disappeared. And when they left King Herod, the star appeared once more and led them to Christ. Amen. Hallelujah. And when they went to Christ, they were there to what? To worship. They did not worship the star, but they worshiped what? Christ. The star was just a messenger to bring them to what? Christ. Amen. And we'll find out that down through the ages, that is just how God has been operating. He has been operating through a what? A star. In every time, in every age, in every dispensation, there is always a star. Mind you, the Bible said we have seen his star, singular, not stars. Amen. So it was not stars that led them to Christ. Amen. It was his star that led them to what? Christ. Hallelujah. Now you will observe that the wise men were not the only people that were living in that time. In that time, they also had the Sadducees, the Pharisees. Amen. King Herod's house was there. They were well-educated men there too. But none of them saw the star. None of them saw his star. But it took only the wise men to see his star. So why is it peculiar that in an age like that, amen, nobody could see the star. It just took the wise men alone to see the star. But Abraham said that the wise men saw the star because they were expecting it. Amen. Hallelujah. May the Lord be our help. Abraham was speaking here in at thy word. He said, but now you remember the wise men, what they see when they followed to Jesus. Nobody else saw it. It passed right over the observatory. Every planetarium, is that right? And every city had a planetarium. They kept time by the stars. Is that right? And isn't it strange that them wise men went right through city after city, city after city, following a star, that even the stargazers and the men in the planetarium that were watching the star to know the time, amen, telling the time and things, never saw nothing of it. Amen. Hallelujah. They were looking for it. That's where it's at. You get what you expect. Amen? So these wise men, they were expecting the star. And since they were expecting the star, they saw the star. Now, it marvels you sometimes to understand that you have seen this message. You've seen the revelation of the serpent seed. You've seen the revelation of the seven seals and everything. But some other person, maybe your classmate, and you're trying to let them understand the mystery of the seventh seal or the revelation of the serpent seed, they keep arguing. Even when they do not have proof, they keep what? Arguing. Because they cannot see it. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But Abraham said they are in expectation. Permit me, I'll be reading from the quote to quote. Amen. I don't want my idea. I just want to stay with the word. Amen. So permit me. Expectation and leadings of the spirit. But Abraham was saying here, this wise man was expecting that star to rise. Amen. They were expecting that star to rise. And all at once, they saw it. And remember, they kept time. They know what time of the night it was by the stars. They had an observatory on top of every city, just like a tower on top of every city. There will be a watchman. Amen? The watchman there will be gazing at the star. Through the star, the watchman will know the time of the day it is. Little one that they say, watchman, watchman, what of the what?
See, so the watchman stays on top of the observatory to watch at the star. So in every city, they had an observatory. But none of them saw the star. It took only this wise man to see the star. Amen. See, they had an observatory on top of every city. And there was a watchman set up there. And they go to ask what time it was. He'll tell them by the moving of the stars. Now, that star crossed the entire nation over every city, and every astronomer looking in the skies, and none of them saw it. Say, but those who were looking for it. Abraham said, certainly. Hallelujah. So whatever you come to the house of the Lord expecting, invariably, that is what you would receive. If you come here expecting to see somebody that knows how to use words and things like that, you will see that. If you come here to see somebody that doesn't know how to use his tenses, you would see that. If you come here to receive the Holy Ghost, you would receive it. If you come here to be healed, you will receive it. Remember, you must come under expectation because you get what you expect. Just like the wise men, as they were moving, they saw it because they were expecting it. So what was the expectation this morning? What was the expectation? What did you come here expecting? Hold on to your expectation. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. It will come out clear by his grace. Amen. Now, I would like to ask a question. Why were they expecting it? Because the Sadducees were not expecting it. The Pharisees were not expecting it. The Sidon Council, we are not expecting it. Even if they know about it, even if they know that it will be Christ will be born in the Bethlehem and all the likes, they know everything, but we are not expecting it, even if they had a fair knowledge of it. So why were they expecting it? Brother was saying here, the great coming revival and the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, 1954. He was saying here, and as it was with Jesus, so was the morning star at a sign to the wise men that came from the east. They had heard that there would be a star of Jacob rise. Amen. Balaam the prophet, remember when Balak called Balaam to come and curse the children of Israel. And for three times, instead of Balaam to curse the children of Israel, he was blessing the children of Israel. Sometimes you wonder, people say they will curse you. They cannot curse you. Because Balaam could not curse them. He went this way, he went that way, he could not curse them. He said to Balak that, how can I curse who God have blessed? That Jacob is blessed. And if you curse him, you are cursed. And if you bless him, you are blessed. So when you move life, amen, move through life without confidence. Amen? Move through life without confidence. That nobody can just wake up one morning and then cast a spell on you. Amen. So Balaam, he prophesied that there would be a star rise. Abraham said there that there would be a star of Jacob rise. Balaam, the prophet, prophesied of it. And they knew that there would be a star rise. And this star would be the sign that there would be a king born on the earth. That would be a savior to all the nations. And when they seen his star arise, it was a sign to them to get ready. Brother, if we see his star today, if we can see his star today, amen, because Jesus Christ always have a star. We'll see that as we go along. So if we can see his star today, it will be a sign to us to do what? To get ready. That the redemption is at hand. Amen, amen. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Now, where did they read of it? If you read Numbers 24, verse 17. Numbers 24, verse 17. That is where you will find the story of Balaam and Balak. When Balaam was trying to curse the children of Israel, but he could not curse them, he started blessing them. Amen. So don't worry. When they take your name down there, they cannot curse you. They cannot. And they will look at you and say, you, this man. You, this woman. Amen. It's because they have tried and they cannot get you. So don't live in fear.
Hallelujah.
Numbers 24, verse 17. Say, and I see him, but not now. I shall behold him, but not near. There shall come a star out of Jacob, and a scepter shall rise out of Israel, and shall smite the corners of Moab, and destroy all the children of Sheth. So these wise men, they knew that there would be a star rise. A star of Jacob would rise. So because they knew that, they were expecting to see it. So as you also know that there will be a Malachi 4 before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. So because you know that, you can expect to see that Malachi 4 on the scene. Because you know Revelation 10:7 will come to reveal the mysteries, so you can stay and expect that. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. May the Lord be our help. May the Lord be our help.
Now, what was the star? Remember, the star is not visible during the day. We must understand that. The star is not visible during the day. The star is only visible at night. Hallelujah. It is at night that the star becomes visible. Now, we are living in the night time. Whether you like it or not. Education has what? Failed. Politics has what? Failed. Everything has what? Failed. Even the economists, the great economists of our time, they don't know what to do. Amen. Forget all the stories they are telling you or they are telling us. They don't know what to do. It's so difficult that they cannot even manage it. More than ever before, we are having the evolution of different fields of studies. Yet, we are still having more problems that cannot be solved by those fields. Amen. So the star always is always visible at night. And if there is night in the world today, as we know it to be, that there shall be darkness, gross darkness, then we must be expecting a star. Hallelujah. If there is darkness in the earth today, then we must be expecting a star. So what was the star? And who are the wise men? Abraham said, now the star is a messenger. Remember, the star led the wise men to Christ. Just like someone coming to your house and say, okay, please, maybe someone comes as a messenger and say, oh, maybe in your office, that the boss wants to see you. Please come and let's go to him. You follow the messenger to the boss. Amen? The messenger is not the person you are really going to meet. You're going to meet the boss. But the messenger takes you to the boss. Amen? So that was the star. The star was a messenger that was commissioned to bring them to what? Christ. Now, in every age, God has a star. Now, who are the wise men? The wise men are those that have the ability to recognize the star for their age. Amen. Amen. The wise men are the bright for each age. That is why you must understand that in every age, we don't have stars. We have what? A star. We have seen his star. Singular. The Bible is perfect. So there's no stars in every age. God deals with one man in that age. Amen. The other men will be faithfully taught men to uphold what that man has what? Said. And full stop. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. So, what was the star? We have looked at what the star was and the wise men. Now, remember, since the star, we must have every star in each age. Bible said in Revelation chapter 1, when John was on the island of Patmos, Jesus Christ sent his angel to reveal the mysteries to him. Amen. And then John said in Revelation 1 verse 16, he said, and he had in his right hand seven stars. That is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ has in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. Verse 20 says, the mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches. So we find out here that the seven stars are angel messengers sent to the world churches, the seven churches. Amen. And we also find that the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. So Jesus Christ has the seven stars in his right hand. And remember, his right hand is the hand of what? Power and authority. So he is walking in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks, meaning that he is walking in the midst of the seven church ages by the seven stars. In his right hand is the seven stars. And he's using those seven stars to walk in the midst of the what? Seven golden candlesticks in the seven church ages. Amen. So we find out that in each age there must be a star. There must be a star in each age. Hallelujah. But Brown was saying here in the end time evangelism, 1962, he says, you can't go under a group of men. I defy any time that it ever went, God ever did use a group of men. Say, he uses one man. Say, it's exactly one man at a time. Because two men got two opinions. Say, one man is exactly right. Notice now, every dispensation, it's been that way. All the way down through, it's been that way every time. So at every age, God is using just one man as an angel to speak to that age. And that man becomes his star for that age. Amen. And remember, we are saying that we have seen his star. We have seen his star. Amen. Brother said, and there stood Moses. And you know what Korah said? He said, why? Moses acts like he's the only one that can preach. He's the only one that got the message. Oh, we know the pillar of fire hangs over him. We know that light's over him. We know all that. But he acts like that he's the only one that's got the message. And we see that everywhere today. Amen. People are trying to make for themselves a name. Hallelujah. And they are trying to dispute the prophet and say, is he the only one that has that light? So we also can preach. Amen. Hallelujah. He said he didn't mean that. He didn't mean it that way. He was trying to correct the people. There's too many ideas. You got to listen to something. And what happened? God said, just separate yourself from them. Because I'll swallow him and his congregation in the earth. So you see that in every age, God is mindful of that. God is always mindful of that. He deals with that to that age with a messenger. It must be what? One person. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. May God be our help. Amen. Brown was saying in Seminary Church Age that the seven ages are set forth in Revelation chapter 2 and 3, take the whole span of the fullness of the Gentiles, or the whole time in which God is dealing with the Gentiles unto salvation. In every single age, say Bannon, it says the very same thing in the opening and the closing message to that age. Say unto the messenger of Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, Laodicea, right? This thing said he, and so on. Brown said, yeah, notice here that Jesus, by the Spirit, in every age, addresses himself to only one person relative to the word for that age. So in every age, Jesus Christ is not speaking to the multitude. He is speaking to one person relative to the word for that age. So you must find that person. That is why sometimes we make statements like, this is the only thing, and this is the only correct thing. It's not like we are trying to boast or trying to make ourselves something or peculiar. But we have seen it in the word of God that it must be one person in an age. So once you find that one person, you can beat your chest and say you got it. Amen. 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 Ram said only one messenger for each age receives what the Spirit has to say for that age. Say, and that messenger, and that one messenger is the messenger to the true church. Amen. Say, he speaks for God by revelation to the churches, both true and false. The message is then broadcast to all. But though it is broadcast to all who come within the range of the message, Ram says that that message is received individually, amen, by only a certain qualified group in a certain way. Permit me to say, that message is received by only the wise men for that age. Ram said there that each individual of that group is one who has the ability to hear what the Spirit is saying by the way of the word messenger. So in each age, God is speaking to his people by the way of the messenger. And the messenger will speak to the churches, false and true. So many people come within the range of the message. But that message is received individually. Why are people not concerned about the message? It's because they are yet to be what? Convinced. Amen? Because when you are convinced that this is the only thing, amen, you will be concerned. And it's my prayer that God will convince you this afternoon. Amen. You will live here with a confidence that this is the only thing. Hallelujah. Amen. Ram said, those who hear are not getting their own private revelation, nor is a group getting their collective revelation, but each person is hearing and receiving what the messenger has already received from God. Amen. So you can check yourself out. You must check yourself out. Amen. Because you must receive from the messenger what he has received from God, exactly the same way he received it from God, without adding your revelation to it. Amen. Hallelujah. Let me run along a little. Amen. Ram said here, still in Seminary Church, that in every age, we have exactly the same pattern. Say, that is why the light comes through some God-given messenger in a certain area. And then from that messenger, spreads the light through the ministry of others who have been faithfully taught. So when the messenger receives the message from God, God will raise up men that are faithfully what? Taught. These men are called the fivefold ministers. They will, through their ministry, spread the message of the what? Messenger. But remember, they must not take a collective revelation of it. They must not also add their own private revelation to that what? Message. They must take it and give it to the people the way the messenger has received it from God. And if we have been doing that, then there will be no problem. The problem is that people are leaving the message and his messenger and trying to form something else. Hallelujah. May the Lord be our help. Abraham says, but of course, all those who go out don't always learn how necessary it is to speak only what the messenger has spoken. Remember, Paul warned the people to say only what he said. In 1 Corinthians 14:37, he says, if any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Abraham said, the commandment of the Lord. Say what? Came the word of God out from you? Or came it unto you only? Abraham said, they add here or take away there. And soon the message is no longer pure and the revival dies down. Say, how careful we must be to hear one voice. Hallelujah. One star, one voice. For the Spirit has but one voice, which is the voice of God. Paul warned them to say what he said, even as Peter did likewise. He warned them that even he, Paul, could not change one word of what he had said. Amen? Oh, how important it is to hear the voice of God by the way of his messengers. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Remember, we have come a long way now. Amen. These wise men, they were coming. Amen. They saw his star. They recognized that it is the star of Jacob arising. They followed the star. Amen. A singular star. Now, what were they watching? They were watching the skies. That is only where you have the stars, right? They were watching the skies. And Abraham said that the first Bible was the Zodiac. Amen. And the second Bible was the pyramid. And the third Bible was what? This is the written Bible we have now. The Word of God. Amen. The written Bible. Amen. The written Bible. So these men, they were not watching just anything. They were watching the Zodiac. They were watching for his star. Hallelujah. So if we are looking for his star today, we must be watching through the Bible, because that is what we can watch now. You cannot just go out there and look at a star and say you're trying to look at a star to find a star that you will now start following that will take you to a particular place where you will see Jesus Christ. Amen. You cannot do that now. But in that their time, the Zodiac was the Bible they had. And they could look at the Zodiac and find a star of Jacob arise and follow that star to a particular physical place where Jesus Christ is. But you cannot do that now. But you can also watch from the Bible, because that is the word of God for today. Amen. There was a time it was the Zodiac. There was a time it was the pyramid. And now it is what? The Bible. So when you watch from the Bible, you can find out that there is supposed to be a star in this age. Amen. Hallelujah. There's supposed to be a star in this age. Only from the Bible can you find that. Amen. Now, when the wise men, when they went to King Herod's palace and they started chatting with him, that where is he that is born the king of the Jews? You will observe that the star was not visible to them. That is why Abraham said that this message cannot be denominated. Hallelujah. You cannot denominate the message. Because when you denominate the message, the star will leave you. You will think you are following the star, supposedly. But you are not following the star. The star and Christ cannot be found in a denomination. That is why he said in his word, say, come ye out of her, my people. We are called, is a calling out. It is the third Exodus. A calling out. Amen. And it is only when you come out that you can now see the star. Because when the wise men came out from King Herod's palace after chatting with him, when they came out, they said they saw the star again, and the star led them to Christ. And when they saw the star again, they rejoiced. Hallelujah. But when they were in that denomination, they could not see the star. And Abraham said that whenever you do anything and you make a mistake, say, come back to the word. Come back to the word. Amen. Don't try to justify it. Don't try to make it look true. Amen. You are a mortal. You've made a mistake. Just come back to the word. When you come back to the word, you will see the star appear again. But the problem is, people don't want to come back to the work after the mistake. So they keep winding up from one thing to the next thing to the next thing to the next thing. Amen. May the Lord be our help. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Remember, denomination is of the devil. Amen. And it's one thing to leave the denomination, and it's another thing for the denomination to leave you. It is one thing to go out of Egypt. It is another thing for Egypt to go out of you. And my prayer is that Egypt will go out of you, even as you have left Egypt. Amen, amen. Hallelujah. Brother Abraham was speaking here. He says, the God of this evil age. Brother Abraham said that, then how can the bride of Christ associate in a denomination, in a denomination, when one is disobedient and the other is obedient? Say, how can one be the word and the other one perverted word? How can a prostitute and a clean woman work together in agreement? Say, they can't do it. They have no fellowship at all. Say, come out from amongst them. Now, sometimes when the pastors say, don't go to this, don't go to that, don't go to that, the reason is because we have seen his star. And there's something peculiar about that star. You cannot marry the star and another thing together. It will not work. You will think it is working, but it will never work. When you see the star, you must come out amongst them and follow that star only. Hallelujah. Say, it's of the devil. It's the mark of the beast. I'm not the one that is saying it. The prophet said, it's the mark of the beast. Heading right into it now. All denominations. Amen. So you cannot try to segregate or separate this one from this one. No. But I say all denominations. I don't care whose it is. Call it whatever name you want to call it. I don't want to call their names for decency's sake. But call whatever name you want to call. All of them that you can call and you can think of and you can mention are all heading towards the mark of the beast because they have not seen his. Because they have not seen his. Hallelujah. Brother said, God is taking not a denomination. Say, a people for his name. A denomination will receive this truth. A denomination won't receive this truth, rather. It will take an individual person that can see God, look at his word, and believe it, and belong to no organization, but live for God, not for his organization. The intellectual wisdom of some bishop or something has taught it. That's right. Amen. So you cannot find his star in a denomination. And if you're in a denomination and you're also in trying to follow the star, it will not work. You must choose. It's either you come out from the denomination and follow the star wholeheartedly, or you better leave the star and follow what you want to follow. Amen. Because at the end time, every man will fall to his own lot. Hallelujah. Amen. But remember, when they left that denomination, once more again, they saw his word, star. And we are saying right here that we have seen his star. Why? Because the Revelation 1 made us understand that there is 7 stars in his right hand. And he is using those 7 stars to walk in the midst of the 7 golden candlesticks. And everybody on earth understands that we are living in the last days. Christian and non-Christian. Unbeliever and Christian, they all understand that we are living in the last days. Now, if we are living in the last days, it also means that we are living in the last age. And if we are living in the last age, which is the 7th age, it therefore means that there must be an angel in that age that will receive from God a message and relate that message to his people. And it becomes your business to find that star. Don't think of how can I get to Christ. Don't just be worrying yourself on how you can get to Christ. Just bother yourself on how you can find the star. Brother, once you can find the star, you do not have any problem again. I don't know if you're hearing me. Don't bother yourself on how will I follow Christ? How will I follow Christ? Hey, how will I serve God? No, don't bother yourself too much. Else you have zeal but without knowledge. You can have zeal but without knowledge. Don't bother yourself too much. Just bother yourself. God, who is that star? And remember, you can be coming here through with your parents, but you must recognize it yourself. You must come to a point where that you recognize that this message is the truth. So you become concerned and convinced about the message. But you can just be following everybody coming here and then day to day, but you have not yet convinced that this is the star for this age. So you take it as if it is like every other thing we have there. This is not every other thing we have there. It is hard to believe, but it is the truth. Because there must be one man in each age. Discuss with the people out there. Ask them, who is the seventh messenger? Who is the star for this age? I understand that your man of God is powerful. I understand all those things. But I just want to find the star for this age. Because once I find that star, I know that that star will lead me to Christ. So I am not bothered about how to get to Christ. I'm not bothered on how to get to heaven. I just want to find the star. If I can, by the grace of God, find the star and hold on to that star, I will get to Christ. It is that simple. It is that simple. Amen. And it is so simple that somebody will stumble over it. It is very simple. So you must come to a point where you understand yourself. Not that they told you. That this is his star. And it must only be one. And he will lead me to Christ. So you just follow it. And your life will be blessed. Amen. Now, hallelujah. May the Lord be our help. Amen. The Bible said in Revelation 10:7 that but in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, say, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be what? Finished. So there are mysteries that are left there. There are mysteries. You talk to some persons about the mysteries, they don't understand. Mystery like serpent seed. It has been debated. The most debated aspect of Abraham's doctrine was serpent seed. But they cannot disprove it. Because it has been proved by science. Amen? It has been proven by science. It has been proven by nature because there are some seeds that can crossbreed. We have a liger. A liger is a crossbreed between a tiger and a tiger, a tiger and a lion. It's a liger. We have a zos, which is a horse and a donkey coming together, they born a zos. So it has been proven by science that even a woman at a time, amen, a woman that a white woman got married to a white man, gave birth, and she had a white and a black baby. So the man said, no, I must take care of this white one because that one is my baby. And then the blue one, this one is black. So what happened? What is the mystery? How can you give up a black baby and a white baby as twin? Amen? So when it happened, the woman started confessing that she met with her husband and then met with a black man later on. And the two seeds were fertilized in her and she gave birth to them, but of different fathers. So it has been proven by nature. It has been proven by science. It has been proven by everything. They cannot disprove it. Hallelujah. We have seen his star. Amen. Amen. So Malachi 4 made us understand, Revelation 10 made us understand that these mysteries of God, that we are so peculiar that even Daniel was told to rest in his lot. Amen. John was told to not to write them. That these mysteries will be revealed in this time. Amen. Malachi 4, 5, and 6 made us understand that, behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet. Remember, the wise men, they were expecting it. Amen. That was why they saw it. Amen. And why were they expecting it? Because they read in the book of Numbers that there shall be a star of Jacob rise. So we are now reading in the Bible to also know that Malachi 4 must what? rise. Because God said, behold, I will send you as an individual, Elijah the prophet, before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. Say, and he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a word, curse. Let me run along now. Amen. And that star for this age is to do two things. Amen. Abraham saying every true star does not receive worship. Every true star will always point you to Christ. Hallelujah. May the Lord be our help. Abraham said there. So why is it that people are doing this? Why is it that it is written plainly in the scriptures and in the word and in the sermon books? Abraham said, don't even do that. Somebody wrote a PhD thesis and called him the divine healer, the healer prophet, in his PhD thesis. And Abraham said, you cannot call me a healer. Bro, or a robot is preaching salvation. Can you call him a savior? Amen? So he said, yeah, that, well, why is it that this is happening? He said, now, Abraham said that, now this last day prophet messenger will have such power, that Laodicean church is, that this, he will have such power before the Lord that there would be those who would mistake him for the Lord Jesus. Amen. Abraham said, listen to this very close. Abraham said, there will be a spirit in the world at the end time that will seduce some and make them believe this. So when you see somebody like that, you just pity them. Because there is a spirit that has seduced them to make them believe that this last age messenger is Jesus Christ. Amen. Abraham said there will be a spirit that will make them do that. For there shall arise false Christ and false prophets and show great signs and wonders. In so much that if it were possible, they would deceive the very elect. But this is where I'm going to. Abraham said, but don't you believe it. He is not Jesus Christ. He is not the Son of God. He is one of the brethren, a prophet, a messenger, a servant of God. He needs no greater honor bestowed upon him than that which was John, which John received when he was the voice that cried, I am the one. I am not he, but he is coming after me. Amen. So that is it. As a true messenger of God, we have seen that he did not receive worship. So we can beat our chest and say, because he has fulfilled those two things that the messenger of this age will do, and he did not receive worship, amen, we have confidence that this is the star for this age. Amen. Brown was saying here, that in this last day, there shall be a prophet, not a prophetess, but a prophet. Said, though in this age, there are so many women purporting to give God's revelation than men. And the infallible word says that he will be a prophet. Amen. And he will reveal the mysteries to the end time people and turn the hearts of the children back to the fathers. There are those who say that the God's people are going to come together through a collective revelation. See, I challenge that statement. Amen. It is a bad, invalid assumption in the face of Revelation 10:7. Say, but now, I do not deny that the people will prophesy in the last day and their ministers and their ministries can and will be correct. I do not deny that there will be prophets, even as in the days of Paul, there was one Agabus, a prophet, who prophesied of a famine. I agree that is so. But I deny upon the infallible evidence of the word that there will be more than one major prophet messenger who will reveal the mysteries as contained in the word and who has the ministry to turn the hearts of the children to the fathers. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. As my time goes down and I'm trying to wind down, amen. Now the people who took his revelation from God became living epistles, read of all men. Amen. Hallelujah. May the Lord be our help. Amen. Hallelujah. We have seen his star. We have seen the star rise. And by his grace, we are following that star. Hallelujah. Now you see Herod. Herod was not really a Christian, but Herod told them that they should come after they have seen him and give him a word that he will go and worship him also. But he was in his heart, he was planning to kill the Messiah. Hallelujah. So the first church and the true church, it has always been that way. Right from the first offspring in the world. The first offspring we know are to be what? Abel and what? Cain. Cain killed what? Abel. It has always been that way. The first church has always been looking for a way to silence the true church. So King Herod is an impersonation of Christianity. He wasn't really a Christian, but he said he wanted to go and worship Christ just to lure them so that he can kill the Messiah. And it has always been that way. The first church has been always trying to kill the true church. But in this last day, Abel, the Cain of this age cannot kill this last day, Abel. I don't know if you understand that. The present day Cain cannot kill this last day, Abel. Abraham said here, look away to Jesus, paragraph 47. He said, well, it's practically that way. You can't go to a church and preach unless you have a fellowship card or some identification. And now, one person's like ourselves, we are going to be cut off all that altogether. That's exactly. Because they wouldn't be able to do it. But Ram said, it's tightening. And then, when that time comes, because we are not going to fellowship like this forever. So you better make good use of this time we have. We will not fellowship like this forever. Abraham said, but say it is tightening. Say, and then when that time comes, and the press comes to a place where you are pressed out. When the pressure comes to a place where as if you are pressed out. Abraham said, then watch what I am fixing to tell you in a few minutes. When that came for this last day, that King Herod, when he will come to try to kill the bride of Jesus Christ for this age, Abraham said, watch the third pool then. Amen. You didn't get that. Amen. You didn't get that. Maybe you got it, but you didn't really understand what I'm saying. When this Cain will come to kill this last day, Abel, Abraham said, watch the third pool then. See, it will be absolutely to the total loss. You see? And we are closer than it seems to be. I don't know when, but it's real. Real close. I may be building a platform to somebody else. Amen. So we have seen a star in this last stage as I wind down. We have seen a star. The star has come. The star has told us that last day Cain cannot kill this last day Abel. Because when that time comes, you watch the third pool. Amen. Hallelujah. And this prophet, when he came, he told us some things peculiar about us. Remember, the prophet was to lead us to Christ. And he gave us some peculiar things about our lives. And you better start looking at yourself in the way that the messenger has revealed that you are. Amen. Hallelujah. The Bible was saying in Pergamon church age, said in these last days, the true bride church, Christ's seed, will come to the great headstone. Abraham said, and she will be a super church, a super race as she nears him. Say, they in the bride will be so much like him that they will even be in his very image. I'm speaking about you now. Remember, your name in the book is not John. Your name in the book is not Faithful Chiagozie Momobuchi. It's not that. Your name in the book is a mystery. And when the mystery goes forth, when the word goes forth, your name is being called. Amen. And this is the profile of how you're going to be as revealed by the messenger. And you must take it. You must believe it. But I'm saying that day in the bride will be so much like him that they will even be in his very image. Amen. Say, this is in order to be united with him. They will be one. They will be the very manifestation of the word of the living God. Abraham said that from a little group of the true seed of the world, say God will present Christ a beloved bride. She will be a virgin of his world. She is a virgin because she knows no man-made creed or dogma. By and through the members of the bride, we will fulfill all that was promised of God to be made manifest in the virgin. The members of the bride will love him. Amen? And they will have his potentials. Hallelujah. The members of his bride, they will have his potentials. That means that you are going to have his potentials. For he is their head, and all power belongs to him. They are subject to him as the members of our bodies are subjected to our heads. So he shows here in his word of life. She receives it. She never doubts it. Therefore, nothing can harm her, not even death. Those in the bride do only his will. No one can make them do another. Amen. So what are we saying in essence? We are saying that in this last day, by the precious grace of God, we have seen his star. And I am pleased to tell you that that star is William Marion Branham. Hallelujah. That is the star for this age. If you want to go to Christ, if you ever want to get to Christ, amen, take the message of the messenger and follow that message faithfully. Amen. Follow that message faithfully. When you do so, that message has the potential to take you to Christ. So don't come start wondering, how am I going to go to get to Christ? Follow the messenger and his message, and it will take you to Christ. May the Lord bless you. Shalom.
Hallelujah. 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 I can hear you this afternoon. Glory. How many appreciate that teaching? Brother, you can do better than that. Sister, you can do better than that. Hallelujah. We have seen a star. How many have seen a star today? How many are truly following him? Hallelujah. Amen. But I'm so happy this afternoon. Hallelujah. That I found a star. Hallelujah. And that star, hallelujah, has led me to Christ. Hallelujah. That star did not lead me to church. I said that star did not bring me to another organization. That star did not just bring me to another fellowship place. Hallelujah. That star led me to Christ. Hallelujah. And that is the objective. We are not here to start another church. We are not here to start another group. We are not here to start another denomination. Hallelujah. If you believe that, you are deceiving yourself. But we are here to come to Christ. And Brother Abraham said, hallelujah, that people come to church, but they don't get through to Christ. Hallelujah. And some of us, we've been coming here for many years. We've been coming here for many years. We've been coming here for many years. And yet, we have not gotten through to Christ. Hallelujah. And when you look around, you can see the manifestation. Hallelujah. People are truly not getting to Christ. The reason you move around, hallelujah, stick around. Hallelujah. When you have little trouble, when you have little trial, is because we are not getting to Christ. The reason you go to that OPM, the reason you go to your prayer houses, the reason you go to those places is because you have not gotten through to Christ. Hallelujah. And the messenger is not here to bring you halfway. The messenger is not here to bring you halfway, not just to bring you to 14C. Hallelujah. That messenger must bring you to Christ. Hallelujah. So this afternoon, hallelujah, how many appreciate what I've prayed for? What a gift of God. We found a star. We are following him. Hallelujah. Oh, let's just sing Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound. Hallelujah, that brought us through. Hallelujah, brought us to Christ. Amen. As we invite our brother. Glory. But I am challenging my spirit this afternoon. Hallelujah, for God. Hallelujah, to bust up all this nonsense. Hallelujah. For God to break every hindrance, everything that takes your attention away. everything that makes you face hallelujah this rotten system. Hallelujah. What is the use of God sending you the prophet? What is the use of God sending you the messenger? What is the use of God sending you the star? Hallelujah. Why do you hobnob with Herod? Hallelujah. You think Herod loves you? You think they love you? You think your neighbor and all these people, hallelujah, that's hallelujah taking you around, hallelujah, to all these funny places, you think it is love? For his amazing grace that provided a star. Hallelujah. It's nothing that you did. It's just the grace of God to your life. Like me.
Hallelujah. I wonder how many of us really appreciate that message by the young, vibrant young man. I have seen his star. Or we have seen his star. It is a revelation. It is not enough for you to say we have seen his star. It must be a revelation to you. You can sit down. I remember when I was still young in the message, I was in Uniport. Down sometime, either at 9:90. Some young Pentecostals tried to say some things concerning the star. I got confused because I was still young. They said some things I could not understand. I went to church. I asked some questions. They answered those questions. But I had some mind battles until one glorious night. The Lord himself came down and revealed the person of that star to me. I have seen a lot of things in the message because that revelation is there. It has kept me. It is not enough for you to say, I have seen the star, I know the person of the star. Some things may arise to test your knowledge of the star or your understanding of the person of the star. I was in a church in Warri. The pastor was seeing the star until at a point he was not seeing the star again. I quietly met him and told him, God revealed this message to me. What if your pastor, I mean our pastor here, maybe sometime, if he tells you he's no longer seeing the star, what will you do? That is why it should be a personal revelation, not just to come here, we have seen the star, we have seen the star. So many things are flying in the air. If you have not truly seen the star, it will shake you off. Not to take our time, the time is far spent. You please pardon my voice. I had some cold. I lost a little bit of my voice, so you just bear with me. Shall we pray? Everlasting Father, King of Glory, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for bringing us into your presence. We want to thank you, Lord Jesus, for the route you have taken us, O King of Glory, through the service. Thank you, O King of Glory, for that masterpiece message. My Father, we are glad that, Lord Jesus, we are among the wise men. Not by our power, not by our might, but Lord Jesus, by thy love for us, Lord Jesus. My Father, help us to remain faithful, O King of Glory, till the end. My Father and my God, I pray, Lord, that Lord, you take me out of the way and speak through my lips. Close my lips to the things you wouldn't like me to say. Open my lips to the things you would like me to say so that at the end, your people will have every cause to glorify thy holy name. Thank you, merciful Father, for answering us, for we prayed and we ask in the precious and mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Without wasting time, shall we turn to the book of Luke? Chapter 8, verse 40 to 56, we shall be reading from three different places. Luke chapter 8, 40 to 56. It says, and it came to pass that when Jesus was returned, the people gladly received him, for they were all waiting for him. And behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was a ruler of the synagogue, and he fell down at Jesus' feet and besought him that he would come into his house. For he had one only daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay a dying. But as he went, the people thronged him. And the woman, having an issue of blood 12 years, which had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any, came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her issue of blood stanched. And Jesus said, "Who touched me?" Then all denied, Peter and they that were with him, said, "Master, the multitude throng thee and praise thee, and sayest thou, who touched me?" And Jesus said, "Somebody hath touched me, for I perceive that virtue is gone out of me." And the woman saw that she was not healed. She came trembling and falling down before him. She declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him, and how she was healed immediately. And he said unto her, "Daughter, be of good comfort. Thy faith hath made thee whole. Go in peace." While he yet spake, there cometh one from the ruler of the synagogue house, saying to him, "Thy daughter is dead. Trouble not the master." But when Jesus heard it, he answered him, saying, "Fear not, believe only, and she shall be made whole." For when he came into the house, he suffered no man to go in, save Peter and James and John, and the father and the mother of the maiden. And all wept and bewailed her. But he said, "Weep not, she is not dead, but sleepeth." And they laughed him to scorn, knowing that she was dead. And he put them all out and took her by the hand and called, saying, "Maid, arise." And her spirit came again, and she arose straight away. And he commanded to give her meat, and her parents were astonished. But he charged them that they should tell no man what was done. Let's look at Joshua chapter 10, verse 12 to 14. Joshua chapter 10, verse 12 to 14. Then spake Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, "Son, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon." And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed, until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not this written in the book of Jasher? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven, and hasted not to go down about a whole day. And there was no day like that before it or after it, that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man, for the Lord fought for Israel. Finally, let's turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 21. Says, "Prove all things. Hold fast that which is good." May the Lord add his blessings to his word in the precious and mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. We shall be looking at a topic, God always proves his word and honors the words of his children. The question is, which word? In John chapter 1, the Bible says, in the beginning was the word, and the word was with God. And in the latter part, it said, and the word was made flesh and dwelt among us. That means, God is not different from his word. In Psalm chapter 107 verse 20 says, he sent his word and his word healed them and delivered them from all their destructions. That means that word has the power to heal. That word has the power to deliver from destructions. In Psalm 119 verse 105, it says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. You need lamp in the time of darkness. If you see somebody that is in the dark and he doesn't call for lamp, that means he feels he knows his way around where he is. Sometimes we do that. Maybe you have got so used to your home, when there is no light, instead of you to call for lamp or lantern, you feel you can maneuver your way, and sometimes you might run into some mistakes. And that is exactly the way with so many people. Sometimes they think they can lead themselves. But we understand by the scriptures that God made us like sheep. Every sheep must have a shepherd. And in Psalm 29 verse 5, he says, the voice of the Lord breaketh the cedars of Lebanon. That means the word is so strong. Cedar is one of the strongest wood you can ever think of. And the Bible says, behold, I am the Lord God. That is God speaking. Is there anything that is too hard for me to do? That means there is no situation you are facing that is harder than God. The voice that can break the cedar of Lebanon can break every barrier you are facing right now. And in Matthew chapter 24 verse 25, he says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but God's word shall endure forever. The prophet said, if I was asked to choose between standing in heaven and standing in the word of God, I will choose to stand in the word of God, or on the word of God. Because heaven shall pass away. And in Isaiah chapter 55 verse 11, it says, so shall thy word be that goeth forth out of thy mouth in righteousness. See, it shall not return to it void, but must accomplish the purpose for which it was sent. And if you believe this, you will believe that every promise that God made concerning you will come to pass in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the Message, Minor Church Age, chapter 4, the prophet said, before there was ever a speck of stardust, when there was nothing to worship him, when God was only potentially God, he wasn't God because God is an object of worship. The prophet said that God was an eternal spirit. But in his mind, he has his bride. His bride existed in his mind. It was a thought in him. And the prophet made us to understand that these thoughts are eternal. But the thoughts, when they were expressed, they became word. And in another place, he said, if you can see that the thoughts of God are eternal, you will see many things. To see is to understand. That means if you can see that the thought of God is eternal, you will also see that those thoughts express the word of God is also eternal. And if you can see that and you know that you are part of God's word, you will know that nothing can defeat you. If you have this revelation, you can never be the same. Our problem is that we try to fathom God with our human reasoning. Reasoning is one of the barriers to proving the word of God. In Proverbs chapter 11 verse 24, the Bible says there is he that scattereth, but he increaseth. And there is he that withholdeth, yet he tended towards poverty. You cannot explain it with any adage. In Igbo language, they said, but the Bible is telling you, he that scattereth increaseth. You cannot understand that with your human reasoning. And in Luke chapter 6, verse 38, it says, give. It will be given back to you. Good measures, pressed down, shaken together. How can you give and it comes back to you? But that is the word of God. The Bible says, prove all things and hold forth unto that which is true. You cannot fathom God with your human reasoning. In 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 32, the Bible talked about Elijah. He said, Elijah, when he wanted to call down fire from heaven, says he poured water on the sacrifice, not once, not twice, but three times. How can a man that wants the sacrifice to light be pouring water? But that is according to the word of God. The Bible says that the sacrifice must be washed. And that was why Jesus Christ had to go to baptism or through baptism. When he was asked, he said, suffer it to be so, to fulfill all righteousness. And the Bible says that Elijah poured the water until he filled all the trenches. In 2 Kings chapter 7, the Bible talked about Elisha's prophecy. A prophecy that came in the time of famine. The Bible says that the famine was so much that some even boiled their children and ate. But yet, God's word went forth and said, by this time, tomorrow, shall a cup of fine flour be sold for a shekel? And the Bible says that the king's right hand man doubted it. He said, even if God shall open a window or will open windows in heaven, shall this thing be? And Elisha answered and said unto him, it shall come to pass. You will see it, but you will never partake of it. Because God said it, he had to bring it to pass. And how did he bring it to pass? Through just four lepers that just decided to take a step of faith. Lepers that their feet had been eaten up. They will walk and they cannot make a simple noise. The Bible says as they walk, God, because God wanted to bring his word to pass, he transformed their footsteps and he turned to chariots. And the people had to flee because God was about to bring his word to pass. I am talking about proving the word of God. We try to fathom God with our human reasoning. Jacob, his tricks worked. He could play it on his father-in-law, Laban. Only God knows the kind of science he applied that he could change the color of the unborn sheep. Everything was working in his favor. But when the word of God went forth and said, you must return to your land, that is where I will deal with you well. He started to apply those tricks. He was to meet with his brother Esau. He sent his messengers. They came back. That didn't work. He decided, okay, I will share my men into two. Share my flocks and everything to two. Maybe if he destroys one, there will be one remaining for me. All his tricks, all his human reasoning, all his number six did not work until he wrestled with the angel. Don't apply your number six to the word of God. A lot of us are applying our number six. That is why we have remained the way we are. The Bible says, give, it will come back to you. But you remember one little thing you have to do. Maybe if this money now, I bring out tight money and give it, I will not be able to pay agent fee for the land that I bought. If I do this now, maybe how will I do this? You are applying your human reasoning. If your 9 over 10 cannot solve your problem, your 10 over 10 will multiply your woes. It's difficult to preach messages like this. I can as well tell you, you have made it anyhow. But I'm not here to tell you that I've made it anyhow. I'm here to tell you, you must prove the word of God. Don't be satisfied. We are not here, sweet sermon or sweet messages will not do you any good until you apply the word of God. The angel met Gideon and told him, thou man of valor. The Lord will see to you. He was not satisfied with that. He said, if God is with me, where are his miracles? Why are all these things befalling me or befalling us? He wanted to see the power of God in his life in Israel. And that is why we are here. We need to see the power of God made manifest in our lives. Don't be satisfied with anything. Don't be satisfied with sweet sermon. Don't be satisfied with sweet message. You should be able to see the witness, the power of God in your life. Amen. There is this story. I heard it from a general overseer. He's not one of the ones I call comedians. He's somebody I know, maybe in his little measure, he's a little bit sincere from the way I saw him or the way I see him. He said he was in a certain place. He said one man ran to him and placed something in his pocket. As the man placed something in his pocket, the man wanted to run back. He asked him, come. What did you do? He checked. The man started begging. He said, sir, please, I just came to give you something. I am very poor. What I do is I just am a lesson teacher. I don't even have any job. Maybe little lessons I do. This is what I get. I decided to give you this. It was 50 naira. So I put it and ran away so that you will not feel insulted. He said he called him back and told him, for doing this, I will make use of this 50 naira. He said the following year, when he got to that place, the young man came to him again. He said, do you recognize me? He said, why can't I recognize you? Was it not you that gave me 50 naira the other last year? He said, I came to inform you that today I own my own school. This is not a fake story. Many of us, especially in the message, still apply our number six to the word of God. We are building a house for God. And the other day, Pastor read it here in Exodus chapter 36, verse 5, how the people got offering until they say, we don't need it again. They gave generously. Until you receive this understanding, you will keep thinking that it is for Pentecostals. And because they have that understanding and they apply that simple Bible principle, that is why they prosper. It's not all their prosperity that is of the devil. Let us stop deceiving ourselves. If you have a high revelation, you are expected to do better than that. If one fraudster, one cyber cafe, or your whole boy can convince you to provide help, to get help, I am touching it with naked hand. If one your whole boy can sit in the comfort of his room and convince you to provide it, to get help, and it wouldn't take you so many days to get provide that help, what of God of heaven that is asking you to give, and it will come back to you? Good measures, shake it together. Even the little money you pledge, you cannot bring it. But when your whole boy, one fraudster, tells you to provide help, to get help. I'm sorry to God, this I've not even entered the message. I'm only trying to lay a background for the word, proving the word of God. If you can prove a fraudster, you can also prove God. Let me read this quote. In the message, the word became flesh. See, when God speaks anything, it's got to happen. For it is his thought first, then his word is expressed. Then it's nothing, no matter what comes or goes, it's got to happen. Oh, can you see the infallibility of the word? Oh my. He said, look, God, through his prophet Isaiah, a man who had his ups and downs like we do, had his mistakes like we do, but God got that man so yielded by being a prophet that his words, God's thoughts, hallelujah, God's thoughts expressed through those mortal lips of Isaiah, a man with sin and things I have, with his ups and downs like I have and like. But a yielded vessel to God expressed the thought, God's thought through word. And no matter what they done, Isaiah's words had to be fulfilled. For it was God's thought expressed through Isaiah. There you are. Hallelujah. Oh God, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. When the world is no more, heavens and earth will pass away, but my word shall never pass away. Why? He was expressing in word the thought of Almighty God. And when we by faith can accept that word, it's got to become material. Oh, how it thrills my heart to think thy word forever in heaven, Lord, is confirmed. What God's thought is, he expressed them in words. And here is the living word. Jesus said, he that heareth my voice and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but has passed from death unto life. Not he that goes to church, not he that puts his name on the book, not he that professes, not he that shouts, not he that heals the sick, not he that opens the blinded eyes, not he that speaketh with tongues, not he that prophesies, but he that heareth my words and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall never come into condemnation, but has already passed from death unto life. Oh, brother, let that faith anchor one time in that heart, till those words will be true before God. Then heavens and earth will shake and go away, but that eternal word, that thought that is in your heart, that's expressed by God, can no more fail than Isaiah's words could fall or could fail. There has been thousands looking at the miracles was done and yet could not believe, because Isaiah had expressed it and said, they will not believe it. God's word is eternal. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. God, in the beginning, back there, when he seen the world, he saw you and I here this morning. He saw my baby sitting back yonder. He saw every hungry person in India. He saw every preacher in the pulpit. He saw every hypocrite walking. He saw the whole thing. The infinite mind of God foresaw it. And he said, now to receive that falling grace, I will send forth my son, Christ Jesus. There was the word in the beginning. Before it was a word, it was a thought. Before it was a thought, it was expressed in a word, and the word became material and dwelt among us. Hallelujah. 10 million years, maybe before the word was ever formed, God's thought seen his body, tabernacled in flesh, know to take this thing out of death. Will said, how eternal is the word of God? Oh, times will change. Years will come and go. Aeons of time will pass away. But God's word will remain forever. There it is. In the message, events made clear by prophet, it says, paragraph 52, it says, notice now, the believers wait for that word to be confirmed. See, it was not written by man, but by the Lord God. Therefore, it's not a book of man. Somebody said, it's just some old Hebrew writings. Would the Hebrews write a letter that condemned themselves? Would that fine nation of Jews, self-styled and polished, would they write their own iniquities, condemning them own selves? Certainly not. Tell of his own sins, how they went into idolatry, how they committed fornication against God's word. No, no, they will never tell that proud nation. It's not a book of man. Is a book of God. And the man who sees the visions or hears the voice of God never understood it themselves in many cases. See, man didn't write the Bible. God wrote the Bible. It's not a man's book. It's God's book. It is God's thoughts expressed through human lips. That's what makes it the Bible. A thought expressed is a word. And the beginning was God's thinking. He expressed it through the lips of his prophets and confirmed it by his servants. See, notice, he says, in things that are to be, he says, some people miss Genesis up there, where he said, God repeats himself. No, just you are misunderstanding. God, at the beginning, he said, let there be, let there be, let there be. The world was just that, in a chaos. Even when he said, let there be light, there might have been hundreds of years before light ever sprung in. But when he spoke it, it has to come to pass. It must be that way. And he spoke his word. Them seeds that beneath the water, when he dried up the earth, those seeds came up. What he says must come to pass. He said, when he said, let there be light, it might have taken several years, but because he said it, it must come to pass. Amen. Remember Ahab. God spoke through the mouth of Elijah that dogs shall lick his blood. So many years passed. Even Elijah went out of the scene. But Ahab thought that everything was all right. But we all saw how God brought that prophecy to pass. It doesn't really matter how many years it has taken. All you need is to exercise patience. You need to be patient to operate the promise of God concerning your life. The children of Israel were not patient. Moses had gone to the mountain to meet with the Lord. The Bible says, when they waited and they were tired of waiting, they met Aaron and persuaded him to mold them gods, bronze earrings, and they molded calf and started worshiping and said, these are the gods that brought us out of Egypt. We need to be patient. If you are sure that God has spoken to you concerning any situation, you need patience to operate the word of God. Abraham received a promise from God. God called him when he was just 75 years old and made a promise to him. And for God's word, for him to prove the word of God, the Bible says, or the prophet said, he had to separate himself from every unbelief. The Bible says he did not stagger at the word of God through unbelief. God wanted to make him a father of nations. But he called him with a wife that was past his menopause, or that has got to his menopause. That means the wife was no longer fertile. But because God said it, God had to bring it to pass. That was the same thing with Moses. Moses was brought up in the house of Pharaoh. Moses was brought up in the house of Pharaoh by his own mother. And the Bible says when they saw him, they knew he was a proper child. And the mother was kept sounding it to him, you are a proper child, God raised you up for something. But remember, God told Abraham, your seed will sojourn in a strange land for 400 years. And after that, I will deliver you with a mighty hand. That means it was going to be a battle and not by politics. And to Moses' mother, she was thinking, maybe this child could be a successor to Pharaoh. By the time he succeeds Pharaoh, it will be easy for him to deliver the people. But God has said, with a mighty hand will I deliver the people. Therefore, God had to harden the heart of Pharaoh. God had to make the situation very hard so that it was going to be a very hard battle to fight. But because God said it, God had to bring his word to pass. God spoke to Joshua. You will cross Jordan. And God decided that they were going to cross Jordan in the month of April. The time Jordan usually overflowed his bank. And the prophet said, that seemed to make God not a smart general. A smart general watches the tide. He knows when to cross the people over. But this very general that appeared to Joshua said, it must be at the time that Jordan overflowed his bank. And because it was the word of God, he told them what to do. Let the ark be first. God doesn't like doing simple things. He doesn't look for that situation, when it is very, very simple. When he was asked to come and pray for Lazarus or come and see Lazarus, Lazarus was still alive. He was only sick. But he waited until corruption had set in. There is nothing that is too difficult for God to do. That is why the prophet said, if you can only understand, if you can only see that God's thoughts are eternal, you will see so many things. Most of the prophecies that came through the mouth of God's prophecies, even the people that prophesied those things, did not even understand. Isaiah said, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son. I'm not sure Isaiah understood what he was talking about. But because God said it, he had to say it. God used his lips to express his thoughts. When we are walking with God, we need to believe like Abraham. The prophet said Abraham's children will do exactly what Abraham said, did. The Bible says Abraham believed God and it was imputed unto him for righteousness. If you are a seed of Abraham, you must believe. You must not stagger. You must be patient. It gets me sick when I hear this one. What going for what? Can't you rest on? Why are you running around with all you contact so many spirits? I told the other man, one man that just left his village. He was coming. See, he was coming. Coming for me. I said, what is he coming for? He can't pray for my family. You should be careful the things you do. Whether any
anybody is seeing you or nobody is, nobody, whether somebody is seeing you or somebody is not seeing you, you should be very careful. You can prevail with God if you are sincere. You can call upon God. You can lock yourself up. The prophet had this to say in the message, the patriarch Abraham. Said, now Abraham was just an ordinary man. He wasn't something special. God never called him, as far as we have any record, until he was 75 years old. His wife, which was his half-sister, being 65 years old at the time, they had probably lived together since they were very young, and she was barren and had no children. God called a complete separation to separate himself from the rest of the world and from all of his people and from all of his kindred. There was a special thing for him to do. And when God expects you to do a special thing, he demands a complete separation from any doubt. You've got to come to full obedience, to obey what he says. God demands it. You can't do it no other way. And now, he always sets an example. And that was his example of a complete separation from all of his family, all of his kindreds, and so forth, to walk a life separated to God. Years passed, nothing happened, but still Abraham held on. He was not discouraged. He never staggered at the promises of God through unbelief, but was strong, giving praise to God. Year by year, as it went by, no doubt, many critics came by and said, Abraham, father of nations, how many children do you have? That didn't stagger him. No child. And Sarah was past the time of life of bearing children. Because way beyond menopause, but still Abraham believed God. Just the same. He made preparations for the baby because he knew and was fully persuaded that God could not make a promise and he wasn't big enough to back up. God cannot make a promise that he's not big enough to back up. He says you think the same thing. Regardless of how unreal it seems, how unnatural it seems to the natural mind, yet, God cannot make a promise that is not big enough to take care of. We believe that same thing today. Every true seed of Abraham believed the same thing. No matter what circumstances in, how much knowledge we have accumulated, how many things has happened, how unnatural it is to the natural mind, how foolish it is, rather, to the natural mind, it doesn't make a bit of difference. If God said so, that is it. And the seed of Abraham are settled upon, thus said the Lord. That settles it. We found out at 25 years later, no children, and still God was faithful to keep his promise to Abraham. For Abraham believed God. The little boy came on the scene, little Isaac. Then after little Isaac had come on the scene, then we find out that God gave him a double test. He said, this child, after being now about 115 years old, or 20, Abraham was, he said, I want you to take this, your only son, and take him up to the mountain that I will show you, and there offer him up on this mountain for a sacrifice. In other words, destroy every evidence that he had that the promise will be fulfilled. That's taking away all the natural things. And Abraham said, I received him as one from the dead. And I'm fully persuaded that he is able to raise him up from the dead. That's the people. Now the seed of Abraham, because he raised up from the dead, we were dead in sin and trespasses. And he who was able to change my mind, change my thoughts, change my nature, change me all over, he can do as he pleases. Whatever he says, I believe is the truth. And every seed of Abraham believed the same thing. Abraham, not disobedient to God, in the little boy, and on this morning told the servants, you wait here with the mules, and the son and I will go yonder to worship, and he and I will return. Oh, how is he going to do it? When he goes up to the top of the mountain to take his own son's life, yet he says, the child and lad and I will return. He knew that something had to happen, and he didn't know just how God was going to do it. That is it, isn't his question. He knew that God promised it. That's all we care to know. God promised it. How is it going to be? I can't tell you. But God said so. He will send Jesus Christ the second time. He will come in a physical form. He will claim his own. There will be 1,000 years, millennial reign upon the earth with him, with the redeemed. That's what he promised. And we are looking for that hour to approach. He promised to heal the sick, to raise the dead, to cast out devils. He promised to do it. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. How? I don't know. He promised to do it. We believe it. That settles it. When a man believes God, he believes all he says. And that's the way Abraham believed God. Now was asked to destroy every evidence that his promise would be taken care of, but he was persuaded that God could do it. Now, not only did he give this great promise, he gave it to his seed also. And because Abraham was faithful and kept the word of God, that God promised him and knew that God would raise up this child. And he spared not his own child, but God was a type of God, giving his son, of course, as he packed the wood up the mountain and so forth, as Christ later packed his own sacrifice block up the hill to where he was crucified. We realize that in doing this, it pleased God so well to see that Abraham loved him above everything on earth, even his own son, his only son. He loved him above what anybody could say, anybody could do. He still loved God enough to believe his word. All Abraham's seed believes God like that. They are believing God, and we know that it pleased God so well that here is what he said, thy seed shall possess the gates of his enemy. Thy seed shall possess the gates of his enemy. Remember, thus said the Lord. Abraham's seed believes that. If you are genuine seed of Abraham, the faith that Abraham had in God, it's in you. And you believe that what God has said, God keeps his promise. And he said it. Now remember, he only made this promise to Abraham after he had given him a test. The seed of Abraham must first be tested to see if they really believe the word. Remember, the only way that he could keep the promise of God, because he believed the promise of God and was tested when he believed it, whether he believed it or not. We are brought to that test. The seed of Abraham today is brought to that test. Will we take God's word, or we take what man said about it? Will we take what some organization has made up as a creed and accept that, or do we take what God said? If God's word is true, we believe God's word, regardless of what anything else is. We let every man's word be a lie and God's be true. The true seed of Abraham But before you can become that true seed, you've got to go through the test, like Abraham did himself. He promised not only to Abraham, but his seed would possess the enemy's gates. Oh my, just think. The patriarch was fully persuaded in it. In his test of the promise of the word of God was right. Regardless of what the circumstances were, he still believed the word was right. The Abraham, the great patriarch, never wavered in faith when he was brought to that testing time. He believed that God was able to raise him up from the dead. He believed it because God made the promise. And when God made a promise that he would be the father of nations, and he believed that that was so, he didn't know how it would be when the baby came, after he had trusted 25 years, then asked to destroy the baby. He still knew that God's promise was true, and he gave his son. How do you know that what you may be passing through is not a test, just like Abraham passed through a test? What is your reaction when you are passing through the test? God always proves his word. And I said that God, remember the topic, God always proves his word, and he confirms, he honors the words of his servants. Remember Joshua. Joshua spoke. He said, I command the sun to stand still at Gibeon. I command the moon to stand still at the mount of at the valley of Ajalon. And the Bible says God honored that word. And the Bible records that there has never been a day before it or after it that God so honored the words of a man. Elijah stood one day. He said, as the Lord God liveth, before whom I stand, there shall be no rain nor dew until, as according to my word. That is a man being in partnership with God. He said, until I, Elijah, I call for it, there shall not be dew nor rain. And God honored it. Remember, when the people of Israel sinned against God and molded that calf, God called Moses. See what the people of Israel have done. I am going to destroy them. David or Moses started to talk to God. Have you forgotten how with a mighty hand you delivered them from the land of Egypt? What will the Egyptians say about you? Have you considered that? A man was talking back to God. He advised him, you had better repent of this evil you want to bring upon your children. And the Bible says, God repented. God honoring the word of a man. And the Bible says, these were men of like passion. Why can't you believe God and speak what you believe? Paul said, we believed, so do we speak. Whatsoever you believe, speak. But the problem today is that even when we say we believe, we speak what we don't say we believe. If you believe in your healing, speak your healing. If you believe in your deliverance, speak your deliverance. Whatsoever you believe, speak it. And God will honor your word. The Bible says that Jesus Christ is the high priest of our profession. What do you profess? The Bible says, for with the heart a man believeth unto righteousness, but with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. What will save you is in your lips. What will destroy you is also in your lips. What are you confessing? Just think about it as we close. Every believer must have a testimony. When the champion of the Philistines challenged Israel, and the Bible says all Israel was dismayed and afraid, David could not take it. And when he approached King Saul, he had to give King Saul his testimonies. Yes, with my bare hands, I destroyed the bear that came to devour the sheep of my father. With my bare hands, I devoured the lion. This uncircumcised Philistines will I destroy in the same manner. He was giving his testimonies. Every believer must have a testimony. If you don't have a testimony, you will keep running up and down. If God heals you of headache, when you have stomach trouble, you will also believe that that God that was able to heal your headache can heal your stomach problem. It's when you don't have a testimony, when you have not wrestled with the angel, when you have not prevailed, that is when you'll be running from pillar to post. You can prove God. You don't need to go to APM to prove God. Who is Chibuzo? These men, you need to know their history. Some of you don't know their history. If you knew their history, you will cry for yourself if you have ever been there. I'm telling you the truth. I'm not just saying it for saying it. People are having victories. People are enjoying divine health. The Bible says it is his wish that you prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospereth. That is the word of God. Let it not be strange to you when people give their testimonies. God can visit you if you can truly believe. Don't ever allow your service to God to become a tradition. Coming to church on Sunday, let it not become a tradition. Coming to fellowship on Thursday, let it not become a tradition. Even Monday prayer meeting, let it not become a tradition. That was the problem that Samson had. He said, I will arise as at other times. It became a tradition. The children of Israel made the worship of God a tradition. Go and sacrifice animals. And they were not doing it with sacredness. God told them, the cattle upon the hill, they are mine. Every piece of the forest are mine. If I were hungry, I wouldn't ask of you. Don't allow your service to God to become a tradition. Paul said, I have run the race and I have kept the faith. He did not go with the faith. That was the first church age messenger. And I believe the last church age messenger also ran the race and he kept the faith. He didn't go with the faith. He didn't go with the angel of his presence. He said, wherever this message is preached in its entirety, the pillar of fire is bound to fall down. Whichever family in this church can go to God in prayers, whichever individual, in simple obedience and humility. The Bible says, test and see that the Lord is good. The problem is we have not tested. It's different mouthing it, saying it as I'm saying it is different, but it is when the test comes. Jesus is the high priest of our profession. What do you profess? He said, therefore we believed. So we speak. What are you speaking? The Bible says, out of the mouth of babes has God ordained strength that he might discomfit his enemies. But in another place, it says, can bitter and sweet waters come out from the same source? Ask your question, yourself that question. Remember that Jairus got more than what he bargained for. He made Jesus for him to come and heal his sick child. But Jesus Christ ended up raising his dead child. This morning you can get more than what you bargained for if you can truly believe. Remember, Jesus Christ, he is the same yesterday. He is the same today. He is the same forevermore. Remember, God always proves his word and he honors the words of his servant. If you can truly hold onto his word, if you can truly believe that his words are eternal, even as his thoughts are eternal, you will see so many things in your life. God bless you.
Hallelujah. Glory. God, he honors the words of, he honors his word, and he honors the words of his servant. Amen. Hallelujah. And then for a few minutes this afternoon, you don't have to worry, and don't you be afraid. Joy comes in the morning, troubles they don't last always. There's a friend in Jesus who will wipe your tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your voice and sing that I can make it. I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in God's hand. You don't have to worry, oh, and don't you be afraid. Joy comes in the morning, troubles they don't last always. For there's a friend in Jesus who will wipe your tears away. And if your heart is broken, just lift your voice and say, I know that I can make it. Oh, I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in God's hand. When your friend trials, when they seem to get you down, and your friends and loved ones, where they endure
to be found. Remember, there's a friend in Jesus, who will wipe your tears away and ease your heart. Broken, just lift your hands and say, I know that I can make it. Oh, I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life is in God's hand. Oh, I know that I can make it. Oh, I know that I can stand. No matter what may come my way, my life.
As the music plays softly, just before we invite our pastor. Brethren, God is not a liar. His words, they can never fail. Today, I know you're tired. I can see that some of us, we slept through our the sermons. I know we are weak. I know we have challenges. I know we have troubles. We have tests. We have trials. But God is not a liar. So this afternoon, in your own simple way, in whatever corner where you find yourself, in the midst of all your troubles and challenges, I want you to prove God's word. Hallelujah. Prove God today to be your healer. Prove Him today to be your provider. Prove Him today, hallelujah, to be your baptizer. Prove Him today to be your refiller. Hallelujah. We've been here for a while. I'm also involved in reading the Thanksgiving and prayer requests. For a very long time now, I haven't had testimonies of refilling. For a very long time now, we haven't seen people coming back to say that God has baptized them with the Holy Ghost. So in the midst of all our troubles, in the midst of all our challenges, those things are little things before God, but we'll have our primary assignment. Hallelujah. Rapture is our goal. We are not coming in the second resurrection. So just put all the weights aside today. Hallelujah. And just speak to Him. You don't have to be loud. Hallelujah. Hannah, it was just by the moving of her lips, but she was talking to God. Some of us come to church and we end up in the cry room. We don't get to Jesus. Some of us come to church and they end up in the sister's room. They don't get to Jesus. Some of us come to church and we end up in the pew and we don't get to Jesus. Hallelujah. That is not how far that this star is supposed to bring us. But Abraham said that he has not come to form another denomination. He has not come to form another church. He has not come to form another group. But he's come to find a bride. Hallelujah. For Jesus Christ. He's come to bring us, hallelujah, to Jesus. And Eliezer, when he found, hallelujah, Isaac Rebekah, man, he didn't stop on the wayside. He made sure, hallelujah, he brought her to the end and brought her to Isaac. Hallelujah. And the message of Malachi 4 won't stop us halfway. It would bring us to Jesus. So I don't know what your challenges is tonight, but don't go back with your trouble. Don't go back with that problem that you've come with. Hallelujah. Make sure that you bring it to Jesus.
Shall we bow down our head for a word of closing prayers? Our dear Heavenly Father, we don't even know where to start, but we can just see, oh Lord, that great statement of the psalmist in manifestation. Thou anointed a cup with oil, and a cup runneth over. That in one day, you bestow so much mighty blessings, spiritual instructions in righteousness, spirit spoken word to enrich our souls. Lord, in this place, we don't want to miss anyone. And Lord, we don't want to see anyone remain in unbelieving status. We're looking for your word. I say word a brother read of that is capable of breaking the cedar of Lebanon. It's a hard wood, but your word can break it. Lord, speak such a word into our heart that unbelief cannot stay, but break habits, wrong behaviors. Lord, the spirit of this world, Lord, no matter how strong they are, they will be broken by your spirit spoken word. Grant it unto us, Lord. And I will look in, Lord, to a fortnight time, 14th over, 16th or so. Lord, not to see one another, but just to see you in great mighty moving of the Holy Spirit. Maybe to visit some of our complaints now. We want to be dwelling in the Spirit. We want sealing, refilling. Lord, we still see one or two challenge, handicapped person in our midst. Lord God, we want you to turn their situation around. We want to fill them. Get them ready for heaven. And before they go to heaven, create heavenly place in their being by a supernatural touch to turn their night to day. Grant it unto us, Lord. All the brethren, a song leader, cum preacher, my wonderful son, faithful, Lord, and my brother, Osomelan, Lord, thank you for the portion, the ushers, the deacons, Lord, the technicians, the musicians, Lord, efficient father and mothers. Many of them don't sleep. They stay on their knees praying, Father, Lord, towards the moving of God in the house of God. All the believer worshipers alike, the sisters that stress and strain, oh Lord, to keep our children, our young ones in order so that we can have sane service. Father, may you bless one and all. Thank you, Heavenly Father. We are done now. We want to be on our way home. We want to thank you for the natural rain. May it make way for us to get to our home. Lord Jesus, provide transportation for them that will need them. And Lord, keep your touch on the brethren's vehicle. And take each and every one of us to our home safely. May you prosper us, Lord, in our endeavor to be a Christian. And above all, those who we travel, get back to work, and those coming out from work, may you prosper them alike and keep us all in the center of thy perfect will. Thank you, Heavenly Father, once again for the service. If there are people with challenges that we've not mentioned, thou knowest all things. May you minister to their needs alike and bless the visitors within our gate, O Lord. All this we ask in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. God bless you. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Just coming on behalf of the trustee board. All you need is just move around in this building. And you see great transformation that has already started rapidly. Check under the decks, almost everything in the back here been done. Even I myself, I never have to go to the main back of the building until sometimes last week, and I was marveled for such a great thing. So being so, they will be counting on your response for the continuation of the job. One or two expenses that I will ask you to contribute. We're also managing that to make sure nothing comes on the way of our pledges. If you hear me, can I hear amen? So, do your ideal. And thank you, brother, also for reminding us about that. You know, we come here, you say this, say that, but the spiritual ones, they are catching it. I am confident that God will finish this work so wonderful. Hallelujah. And God cannot lie. God must prove his word. If we give to God graciously, don't broadcast to the old protocol that I want to give. No. She's a cheerful giver. Don't let the whole world know, if it's not this thing now, don't bring that money here. May be cheerful in your heart. Amen. Let it be an affair between you and God. That's why Pentecostal will put the amount of your pledges here. We didn't do that. You just put your name. We leave those things with those who should know about it. So let's wake up to it and get the place ready for beautiful worship. Amen? When the building was going on, when Solomon Temple was being built, nothing happened. But when the job was finished and the dedication was to take place, all you Bible readers, you remember what happened. We appreciate the Lord for it. You believe God can do it for us again? And that reminds me, I'm seeing some faces that were not here. If you have not written your name, meet the chairman or his assistant. Where's Brother Chidi Hart? Meet a trustee board and make sure your hand is into this work. It's for all of us. God bless you. Two quick reminder on your way home. Our beloved brother Joey will be burying the brother on the 6th. And if you have anything you want to support our brother with, kindly meet with Brother Udo. And the Lord will appreciate you, and the Lord will appreciate you also. Amen. Then maybe by next Sunday, we will have worked out our model. Sister Lena Aleme, she was a sister here. She passed away while she was here. What's going to be the nature of the barrier? What's going to be the nature of our involvement? some category of men and women that will meet today. And by God's grace, come next week, we will let you know what we have to do. I wouldn't love to say this, but because there is an humble thing closer to it. As a church, we are slightly big in number. Let's limit our worries to father, mother. As a brother, a sister here. Yeah, your father, your mother, yeah. Directly we will be involved. Directly. But when in a common relation, my uncle, my brother, and things, we try to moderate in direct church involvement. So I pray you will understand that. Otherwise, we won't do any other thing than bury. God forbid. God bless. Okay. Sorry. There will be no Lord's Supper and food washing today. We are closing now for the day. I didn't even remember. If anything like it will follow, I'll let you know. I didn't remember, and that's most unusual. May the Lord bless you.
You appreciate the pastor. And how many of us appreciate the message or the messages? But also, God bless you. Amen. This is time to prove God's word. Amen. Hallelujah. And brother Faithful, God richly bless you too. Amen. So, for the cleanup on Saturday, sisters group C, you're to clean the auditorium this Saturday. And brother's prayer meeting tomorrow, the usual time. See you there. Amen. I saw the light. No more the darkness.
Oh, the light. Oh.
mountain river be lifted up from the air. I will draw men unto me. Oh, lift Jesus higher. Oh, lift Jesus higher. Oh, lift him up for the world to see. He said, if I be lifted up from the dead, I will draw men unto me. Oh, lift Jesus higher. Oh, lift Jesus higher. Oh, lift him up for the world to see. He said, if I
a few more weary days and then